know you are. There's no hope for you here. We welcome everyone. It's good to see all who are with us here this morning. We welcome you to Bayou Baptist Church. Before Al comes and leads us in our call to worship and opening prayer, we have birthdays for the month of November. And there are about 15 birthdays. I don't know where all these people come from, but they're here. I'm kidding. November the 5th, Abby's going to be, how long are you going to be, Ab?
13.
The 10th of November, Cheryl Armstrong's birthday. The 12th of November is Danny Bryant's birthday.
15. How are you going to be, Danny? 13?
19 for the 42nd year.
November the 12th, for those of you who know him, it's Mary Rushing's birthday. It's going to be November the 12th. The 17th of November, Joseph, which is Patricia or Trisha's son, his birthday is November the 17th. Also on the 17th of November is Zachary. His birthday is on the 17th. The 18th after that is, I got this guy here, this young dude, Victor Sr. A young dude over there. He's right there with Danny. He's still 19 years old too, right?
I claim 30.
You claim 30?
Yeah.
There you go. 30 years old. But Victor's on the 18th. The 19th is Sandy Davis. Also on the 19th is Debbie and Johnny's nephew Shane. His birthday is on the 19th of November. The 20th of November is Sandy Deal. The 20th of November is also Miss Colleen Fagan, aka Tinker.
There you go.
So she's on the 20th of November. The 25th of November is my son-in-law Jason. His birthday is on the 25th. The 28th of November is a granddaughter Zoe's birthday. The 29th is Olivia. How old?
11.
All right. And then also on the 29th is Daniel Milton. Daniel's birthday is on the 29th as well. Anyway, anybody else's birthday in November that we may have missed? Yes, you got somebody else now?
Yeah, my oldest grandson, well, my second to the oldest grandson, he'll be 19 on the 5th.
Wow, okay.
And then Elijah's brother, Jaden, will be 9 on the 19th.
Okay, well, good. Awesome. That is awesome. Anyone else? Anyone else in the month of November? I know it's hard to conceive that we only got a couple more days in October and that November will be here for us. Wednesday will be November 1st, believe it or not, so for all of you who are counting down, so yes, so be aware of that. So Mr. Al, come and lead us in a chorus of happy birthday to all.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Whose birthday is coming up in November, a very happy birthday. And if my memory serves me correctly as well, I think Brian's birthday is what, 30th or 31st?
30th.
30th of October, so his is right around the corner as well. He's only 19 years old, so
yeah.
That's awesome. Let's all stand now as Al comes and leads us in our call to worship and holding prayer.
Hymn number 19, we praise you, O God, our Redeemer.
We lay it before you, we kneel and adore you, we
We just thank you for all that you've done for us. And Father, as we sing a song like this, we do praise you for all that you've done for us, our Creator. We pray, Father, for those that aren't able to be with us this morning. Let them know that they're in our prayers, in our thoughts. I thank you for each one that is here, and I pray, Father, that each one is attentive to your word, and each one will receive the word. Pray for our pastors, he brings the word you put upon his heart to us. Let us all, Father, grow in our knowledge, and our love, and our understanding. In thy Son's precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
May be seated.
Again, we do welcome everyone. It's good to see all who are with us. In a way of announcements, on the bottom page of your morning worship, you'll notice a few things. Next Saturday night, you get an extra hour of sleep. Next Sunday, daylight saving time ends. So your clock goes back 1 hour. So before you go to bed, if you go to bed at 8 o'clock, you put it to 7 o'clock. Go to bed at 1 o'clock, you put it to 12 o'clock. So it goes back 1 hour. So you get an extra hour of sleep next Saturday into Sunday. So be aware of that. Next Sunday is daylight saving time ends. The 7th of November is Election Day. There may be some federal places that may or may not be closed, being where this may be taking place. So I don't know. Do we actually have an election on November 7th? Okay, we do have some things that are going on. Yeah, so we do have some elections, so be aware of that. The 11th of November is Veterans Day, so be aware of that as well on both those days. Then the 12th of November, a few Sundays, we'll have our Thanksgiving banquet after the morning worship, so be aware of that. I do have a list here. Anybody who would like to sign up and say, okay, I'm bringing this, I'm bringing that, so that way we'll know. I'll put it back in the foyer, so if you don't mind, please sign. If you do sign, put your name by it so we know who's bringing it and what's going on as far as what's taking place as far with that. So that's going to be back in the foyer area for the 12th of November. Also, we still have some calendars for sale for anybody who would like to have calendars, $5 each, so be aware of that as well. If you would like to see the service, this one or any others later on, there's also the Facebook page website on the bottom of the page there, and also you can go on YouTube as well. Any other announcements or anything else we need to be aware of anything else going on or taking place? If not, Mr. Al, come and lead us another hymn, sir.
473. More love to thee, O Christ, more love to thee.
Oh,
few prayer requests, concerns, and thanksgiving. I ask you to remember each and every one and the many people that we continually pray for on a daily basis. Pray for those who are not with us this morning for whatever reason. Remember them in prayer and pray for them. Pray for all the men and women in the military and their families. Pray for Christian missionaries throughout the world that are proclaiming the gospel. And as always, pray for the lost. Pray for those who do not know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Pray for your enemies, as the Lord has so encouraged us to do. Pray for those who do harm to us or who are not a believer. But I would tell you, do not pray that to where anything may happen to them, but pray that they may come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. As did Paul when he came to know the Lord, and he was a servant of the Lord. Pray that the enemy may come also to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Two reasons. One, for his eternal soul, and secondly, that he too, or she too, can be a worker for the Lord and instill the gospel. So pray for that. But just again, remember the different people on our prayer list and the many that we are praying for on a daily basis as well. Other prayer requests, concerns, thanksgiving, or whatever you would like to share with us this morning. Debbie.
Prayer of thanksgiving, Debbie and Jason and the kids made it to San Antonio safely.
Yes. In the words of Mindy, they're back south again. So they're glad to be back south, and they are now, I think, officially living in San Antonio, Texas, so they're no longer residents of California. But they won't be moving into their house until November the 2nd, but they are in San Antonio right now, so they seem to, it was a good trip, so that was good as far as with that. Also, prayers of Thanksgiving, my wife and I last week, as we was in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, had a good trip there, back, and while we were there. Nice weather and all. And also we got to see Joe and Brent Frazier, which was also good as well. Pray for Joe and Brent Frazier. They have a lot going on with them and what they're doing in the Tennessee area as well. So pray for them. But it was all good. So prayers of thanksgiving. Others? Think.
I have a prayer of thanksgiving.
Okay.
I would like to thank God for some very close and dear friends who called me a couple of days ago and said that I have been on their mind.
Okay.
And they're coming after church today to kidnap me and take me to their house in Prairieville for a couple of days. And I told them I have cataract surgery, which I will need prayer for, this coming Wednesday, because
okay.
They wanted me to stay all week.
Right.
But they said, not a problem, they'll bring me home Tuesday.
Okay.
And I told them, I said, you know, 2 days, that's not much to come all this distance to get me and then bring me home. And they
right.
said they didn't care.
Okay.
So I oh, just want to thank God for such loving friends.
Awesome. That is awesome. And your request as well. Remember, you would pray if you have cataract surgery this coming Wednesday?
This coming Wednesday, yes.
So remember you with that, as you will be going through that, for sure will. Absolutely. Johnny.
Yeah, Frank, great Thanksgiving as well. Debbie had a procedure Monday, and with her esophagus.
Yes.
And she's doing a lot better now.
Oh, good. Oh, good. That is a prayer of thanks. So we'll just ask that you continue to pray for her and continue to pray for you with your treatment for cancer and your dealing with that. And also, traveling mercies for y'all as y'all will travel next weekend. They're going to spend a weekend with Madison up in that far country of Louisiana, Lafayette.
Acadia.
So just pray for y'all with traveling mercies as y'all go there. Because you are taking your camper there with you. So traveling mercies for y'all as y'all travel there and travel back and while you're there as well. Other prayer requests. Ms. Renee.
My dear family members.
Yes. Sure will. Pray for them and pray for y'all as well. We sure will. Ginger.
Renee, let's continue to pray for each one in my family and the different things going on in their lives. And
yes.
Husband and myself and children, grandchildren.
Yes.
And also for Zach. I talked to Zach last night, or yesterday afternoon.
Okay.
And I think he's had his experience with some cough troubles. And also, he's studying really hard for a test he had taken. He wasn't as pleased as with the score as he should have been, so he's going to retake it, so he's doing a lot of studying. Pray for him and hoping the Lord will help him out and so he can get in school, because he eventually wants to be a lawyer.
Okay. All right. So,
pray for him that, for everything that he's going through.
Is he still in Oklahoma?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. All right. All right, so continue to remember Zachary in prayer and while I deal with him as well with that, but just continue to remember your family and remember you all in prayer as well. Others? Miss Virginia?
I'd like for y'all to pray for me because I've been having to go to the doctor. They don't know exactly what's going on.
Okay.
And I got to go back again this week.
Yes.
And then he said it's going to take a while. He's trying to find out exactly where it's coming from and everything.
Okay.
Right leg is still 100%, it's good.
Okay.
The left leg is the one she's still having a little swelling, so we did some tests on her the other day, and then we have to go back Thursday for the results of that.
Yes.
And
okay.
He was thinking that her leg problems may be caused from her lower back.
Right.
So I have an appointment with Dr. Butler on the 8th of November for him to check her out. So.
Okay, so I want to remember you with that.
He said the stents looked okay, though. We don't see a problem with those.
Sure. Okay, so continue to remember you with that with your physical problems, and remember you, Linda, that you take care of Mom. Sure will.
All right, Danny. Danny had some problems with his knee this past week, but
he's doing better.
He said he's feeling a lot better.
Well, good.
Yeah.
Good. Awesome. Any others? Miss Renee.
Please continue to remember Melissa.
Okay. Yes.
School is very hard.
Yes. Yes. Nursing school is very hard, if not easy.
She
you're right.
Studies all the time.
Sure. You know. Yeah, and even what I understand, even after you get out, you study some more. It's an ongoing study, but they make you take continuing education courses as well. So, yeah, so we'll remember Melissa, as well as others in prayers for that. We sure will. Yes. I know it's hard. It's difficult. We sure will. Again, just pray for the different people on our prayer list. Mr. Billy Lynch's family, continue to remember him in prayer and the family. Ronnie's still dealing with this cancer and relationship with that. His brother Harvey still has cancer. He's still in Kentucky, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I talked with him yesterday.
Okay.
He said that cancer's still eating on that bone.
Still eating on that bone.
So he still says, I'm doing fantastic.
That is good. That's a good attitude to have. So we want to remember your brother, Mr. Harvey, in prayer, as well as his wife, Debbie. She has some physical problems that she's having as well. And then also Miss Ruby with her terminal cancer as well. And both of them are doing wonderful when you talk to them, right?
Right.
I mean, so that's great. That's great. I mean, that's good. So I want to remember them and remember you in prayer as well. Yes, I know all this is hard. With all of that, so we remember y'all in prayer. Anyone else? Ginger.
Frank, I also forgot. I talked to Lindy Mel, ESA Zach's other grandparents.
Yes.
And she has scheduled surgery on one of her legs November 14th.
Okay.
She wanted to make sure that Mike got surgery done first, but they having problems with workman's comp. She said nothing's coming through. They keep sending to different doctors. And
okay.
So anyway, so she's going to go ahead with surgery on one of her legs.
All right.
On the 14th, so it's scheduled right now.
So remember
her upcoming.
We sure will. Yes. Traveling mercies, just in general, everyone traveling back and forth, going in work or whatever you may be doing, as we get busy now with the holiday season. It gets more hectic. People get crazier than they were before because of the holiday season. So I would tell you, be careful. Just pray for help and just pray for those as they travel in about, not only just in the city, but just anywhere, especially since we're coming into the holiday season. So just pray for guidance and for help. Remember the many people who, again, have been forgotten, especially in the nursing homes. Continue to pray for many in nursing homes and where they are. Some are being remembered, but for the most part, most are forgotten, of course, with all of that. So just pray for those in nursing homes. Again, pray for those who are not with us this morning for whatever reason may be. We have a few that are out today. Pray for them and remember them also in prayer. As always, no matter what you may be going through, no matter what may be taking place, always give thanks to the Lord. The Word of God says give thanks in all circumstances, all things. And I know sometimes it's hard, sometimes it's difficult depending upon what you may be going through. And I always bring to mind Daniel. Daniel went through a whole bunch, but yet three times a day, he would go into his room and he would give thanks to the Lord. Lord, thank the Lord. We should do the same. Give thanks, Lord, for all that he's done and all that he's given to us. Remember, it's by his hand. There's always a reason for everything. Give thanks. Sometimes we may not like it, but happens. There's always a reason for it. Give thanks to the Lord and praise him and glorify him and let others know. Spread the gospel. Let others know about Jesus Christ. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Almighty God, as we come before you again this morning, Lord, we lift up all these prayers and all the concerns, the many that have been voiced here and the many unspoken as well. We lift them all up before your throne of grace and mercy. And we ask for mercy. We ask for help. We ask for healing. We ask, Lord, for your strength and your help in our lives as we go through different things. Many are dealing with different health issues and health problems. Some are dealing with things at work. Some with things at home, or even the battles and the things that we have going on within ourselves. We pray for your help, for your grace, and for your mercy. Be with us, Lord. I pray and we lift up all the prayers. For those who are not with us this morning for whatever reason, we pray for them and we lift them up before you. Again, the many prayers that have been voiced with the many people and the many things that are going on and taking place. All that we see happening in the city, in the states, and throughout the U.S., the chaos, and the many other things taking place, Lord, we pray for help, we pray for grace, and for mercy, and for strength. We thank you for your many blessings, we thank you for all that you have done and are doing, and just ask that you'll continue to be with us, lead us, guide us, and direct us, Lord. We thank you for your many blessings, and we thank you for Jesus Christ. We lift up the many who do not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We pray for the lost. We pray for whomever they may be, a friend, a co-worker, a family member, or even somebody we've never met but yet may need. And just help us to spread the gospel and let others know that Jesus Christ died for them. Be with us now. Lead us and guide us. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen. Let us stand now as Al comes and leads us in our offertory hymn.
202, 202, all hail the power of Jesus' name.
Bring forth the royal diadem.
pray. Almighty God, again we come before you and we thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. Lord, we come now and we give you back a portion of what you have blessed us with. We ask, Lord, that you will see to it that all is collected, is used for the furtherance of your kingdom for the spreading of the gospel. And Lord, may you bless both the gift and the giver. In the name of Jesus we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Today's message is coming from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 17, being thankful, but also it's a story about salvation as well. And this song is one that says it's saved by grace. He says, I found a friend who is all to me in love. As he began his ministry, He would constantly heal people throughout all the regions. And he would heal people of every disease and every kind of sicknesses that were among the people. And it didn't matter whether that person was a Jew or a Gentile. If they came to him and said, Lord, heal me, he would heal them. People would come to him, or he would go to people. People who were demon-possessed. People maybe with small things, like maybe a fever. Or there would be different types of healing or health issues that would take place. People need healing because they were lame, or maybe blind, or couldn't speak and they were mute, crippled, and many other health issues or demonic things that were taking place in the lives of these people. And again, it didn't matter whether they were a Jew or whether they were a Gentile. He would come and heal them. So consequently, what happened? News about him spread throughout all the regions, and scores of people would come and be healed by his divine touch or his word. And understand this, if you look at the miracles that Jesus had done in the Gospels, almost every one he did for the people were done differently. Almost never was any two the same. Even if he healed someone who was blind, he would have it done in a different way, in a different manner, for a reason and a purpose. Amazing of how our Lord so administered all of this. So here, in Luke chapter 17, in verses 11 through 17, this is a true story of 10 men who had leprosy. Now, according to John chapter 11, in verse 54, Jesus had left Bethany after raising Lazarus from the dead, after Lazarus had been dead for over 4 days, and he raised Lazarus from the dead, he went to a small village by the name of Ephraim. And while there, he is confronted not with just one or two people here with leprosy, but 10, and all at the same time. 10 men. And it doesn't tell us about the other 9, but we do know that one of them was a Gentile. We can only surmise or think that the others maybe were Jews, or maybe they were Gentiles and Jews. But evidently it was a mixture in there, maybe. And this is a story now of gratitude, of worship, and salvation, while at the same time, it's also a shocking tale of ingratitude as well that is being looked at here. So let us look at what is taking place. First of all, in verses 11 through 13, 10 unclean men. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. And as he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." Now, this was a common thing for people with leprosy back in Jesus' day to do, not to call him Master, but usually if a person back then had leprosy, they would call out to the people if they came in contact with anyone who did not have it. They would say, basically, they would call and say, "We have leprosy," or "We are unclean," or something to that nature, to identify themselves, if you could not already have noticed that, because they were, maybe in some cases, they had their hands bandaged, or their face bandages, or some part of them bandaged from the deterioration of the flesh due to the leprosy that was taking place. But here we see, when Jesus entered the village of Ephraim, this is the village as pronounced in John chapter 11, 10 men with leprosy approached him and they cried out to him for mercy. Now these men, again, as I mentioned, they were outcasts. They could not live with society. They were not allowed to go to the temple. They were not allowed to even go in different places because of their leprosy and the chance of infecting someone else. And so they were outcast and they had no one else to turn to except Jesus. Now, in all probability, they heard about the healing power of Jesus, maybe either from other people or maybe from a distance, seeing for themselves what Jesus had done in the lives of other people. We don't know. But either way, these 10 men, together, in unison, they call out to Jesus and say, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us," coming to him for healing. You know, today, so many people, they hear about Jesus. And they have their own needs that they need to have in their own lives. But you know what happens sometimes? They think that they are not worthy to come to Jesus. And so some who are so deep in sin, or just sinners, period, think that they cannot be healed, or that Jesus cannot help them, or in some cases, they believe the lie of Satan, who will tell people that Jesus will not accept them as they are, that they're not worthy enough to come in the presence of Jesus. They're not worthy enough to come into the house of God to worship. And this is a lie that is being spread by Satan, because they don't want the people to come in and to hear the gospel, to hear the fact that Jesus died for them, and that they can receive mercy and help. So they'd rather believe a lie than the truth in some cases. Again, many come because they feel like they're not good enough, and they do not come into the presence of the Lord. But our Lord so said in Luke chapter 5, and in verse 31, he relates to the Pharisees and the teachers of the law concerning sinners, tax collectors, and those whom the Pharisees and the Sadducees looked down upon and said, "You're not worthy enough. You're not good enough. You cannot come in the presence of God." And when after Jesus called Levi and he was associating with the people that Levi associated with, tax collectors and others, they complained to disciples and said, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? And in Luke 5:31, Jesus answered them, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." And this is so true. Like these 10 unclean men calling out to Jesus to seek for mercy, so too, the sinner, the person who thinks they're not good enough, should seek out the Lord. But Jesus also says, "Come unto me. I have come for this very purpose. Why did God send his Son? He sent his Son to die on the cross for our sins, so that by his blood we can be cleansed and made whole again. This is the reason God sent it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever comes to him can have eternal life without any stipulations whatsoever." And he says, "Come as you are." Again, it's an awesome thing. Jesus says, "Come unto me, and I will give you rest. Come unto me, I will give you healing. I will give you mercy. I will give you the help that you need and that you are seeking." Again, there are so many people that are seeking help, and so many are seeking in the wrong places. The place to seek it is with the Lord Jesus Christ, just as these 10 men who were unclean and came seeking mercy and calling out to Jesus as well. I tell you, do not wait until it's too late. But settle the matter today concerning your old life and the old sin in your life as well. You know, I often think, how many people who have delayed, have not settled the matter, and have said, "You know, I'll do it another time, or I'll do it some other time." And before you know it, they're dead. They lift their eyes up in hell and said, "I wish I would have. I wish I could have." How many people have not settled the matter? They believe the lie that has been circulated around by Satan rather than believing the truth of God. And never settle the matter of their own personal relationship with Jesus Christ and saying this. You know, we don't need to be afraid. No matter what type, what kind, how many sins, it doesn't matter. Do not be afraid. You know, in Romans chapter 10 and in verse 11 through 13, here the word of God so says, as the scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame, for there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who calls upon him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And then also, in Hebrews chapter 4, in verse 14 through 16, here the word of God so proclaims, therefore, since we have a great high priest, who is that? Jesus Christ. He is our high priest, who has gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, for we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we what? May receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Now I ask you, are not these 10 men doing exactly that? They're coming before the Lord. Lord, have pity upon us. Have mercy upon us. They are approaching the Lord Jesus Christ for help and for need. Even though there's no telling what they look like, even though they were considered unclean, which they were, and even though this leprosy was full, they were full of, they still came and approached and ask the Lord for mercy and for grace. Again, I urge you, do not delay the matter. Make it a priority to do it today. What we only have today. No one is guaranteed tomorrow. If we do this today, then you know, if you put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ, you can have eternal life by putting faith in him. Repenting of your sin. So we had these 10 unclean men coming before Jesus and said, Lord, have pity on us, have mercy. We need your help. And so what do we see in verse 14? This awesome thing here. Again, Jesus does it in such a way. Again, every miracle that Jesus has done, he's done it differently for whatever reason or purpose. We have no idea, but he's done it. And notice in verse 14, when he saw them, he said, go show yourself to the priest. And as they went, they were cleansed. Amazing, isn't it? 10 clean men. Not one, not two, not three, all 10. They were cleansed. They were healed. They were no longer outcasts. They were no longer isolated as well. And notice the amazing thing. Jesus didn't touch them. He didn't do any kind of special effects upon them or anything else at all. But yet, all 10 were physically, completely, instantaneously cleansed of all traces of their disease. Instantly. As they went, they were healed. Why? What happened? What did they do to receive such a healing? Very simple. They obeyed the word of Jesus. What did he tell them to do? Go. Show yourself to the priest. Now, when they went, they were still lepers. As they went, it says, they were cleansed. They believed his word. And they immediately acted upon the word of Jesus without hesitation. I could see all 10 of them just turning around and going toward the priest, even though they were probably still with leprosy. And as they were going, I don't know, maybe they looked at each other and said, hey, you're Clint. You no longer have that. And the other guy said, well, so are you. And I could just see each one of them relating to each other that they no longer were affected by the disease. They were all cleansed and made whole that day. Why? Because they put their faith in the power of Jesus to heal. Understand, in Jesus' day, and even today, there are many, many people, sadly, that do not act upon the word of the Lord. And they suffer for it. They suffer physical, but they also suffer eternally as well. They suffer lost blessings and also lost healings as well. You know, in Matthew chapter 7, and in verse 7 and 8, the word of God again proclaims, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, the door will be opened. Now, did they not come to Jesus and ask? And did not Jesus give them this healing power to where they came upon? Again, they came and they asked for mercy. And while they obeyed and on their way, they were healed. But you know, throughout the Bible, in both the Old and the New Testament, there are scores of people on both sides. Many who have obeyed the Lord and received blessings, and many who have not obeyed the Lord, and we see they have not received any blessings. If you go to 2 Kings chapter 5, you read the story of Naaman, who was a Gentile captain. And he was told to go wash in the muddy waters of the Jordan 7 times. He didn't want to do it. I'm not doing that. I'd rather go in the clean waters of Abita Springs. I don't want to go here. I don't want to go into Mississippi or Lake Pontchartrain. You know how dirty that water is over there? And then the servant said to him, Master, if he had told you to do something else, would you not have done it? So he thought, he says, no, he's right. But the whole point of it was is that God was to get the glory. It was to show that it was God who was healing, not the waters. But yet he went and he obeyed. He went and he dipped 7 times. And he was healed of his leprosy. And this was a Gentile. And yet on the flip side of that, you see a king who was supposedly devout to God, a king by the name of King Saul in the Old Testament. And he was told by God, here's what I want you to do. But yet he disobeyed. And as a result, he lost the kingdom because he disobeyed the word of God. Again, there's so many stories. Abraham obeyed the word of God. Go and sacrifice your son, your only son. And he did. And he was blessed. But now he didn't actually sacrifice him, but he was going to. Then you have the people of Israel. We see the same thing here. What's taking place? They were told by God, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go into the land of Canaan. Go into the promised land. Oh, we can't do that, Lord. You've seen those people? They're big. They're too big. They're giants. But the Lord says, I'm with you. I'll take care of it. Well, again, they disobeyed the Lord. And what happened? They wandered in the desert for 40 years. And that's unnecessarily why. Because they disobeyed the Lord. And we see so many stories in both the Old and New Testament of both people on both sides where you obey or disobey. And today the same thing happens. We are blessed if we obey the Lord, regardless of what is said. And, you know, sometimes I know that it contradicts or it may go against what we have been taught growing up concerning the things of God. And we have to throw those things away. Regardless of who you've been taught by, whether it's been by parent, grandparent, or whomever. And it maybe contradicts what the Word of God says. First and foremost, obey the Word of God and what it says. More than anything, even if you don't understand it. Now understand, God is not going to tell you to do something that's going to be so evil and so terrible in every case. But understand, To obey the Lord is better than sacrifice, the Word of God says. And this is what the 10 men did. Even though they could see where they maybe were not healed at first, they went in obedience to the Word of God. And the 10 men obeyed the Word of God, and they were cleansed. They were made whole again. Amazing, isn't it? From just that moment, I don't know how long it took. I don't know if they went just a few hundred yards, if they went a half a mile. I have no idea how long it took from the time they turned around and they were going to the priest in obedience to God's word to when it actually happened and took place. All they know is as they went, they were cleansed. They were made whole. Why? Because they obeyed the Lord and his word. Today we need to do the same thing in our lives. Is obey the word of God. You know what the word of God says? And if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, if you believe that he died on the cross for your sins, that you will be saved. That's the word of God. You're saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast. That's how simple it is. But yet so many people believe the devil's lie again. Oh, it can't be that simple. Yes, it is. This is why God came. God sent his son. This is why he came. So that you can be made whole again. And then the last thing we see. In verse 15 through 17. Or 15 through 19. We see one man was completely made whole. 10 men were healed on the way. But yet only one out of 10 was made completely whole. Look at what happened in verses 15 through 19. One of them, when he saw he was healed, he came back. Who did he go back to? He came back to the Lord Jesus Christ, and he was praising God in a loud voice. Oh, he was so happy. Ah, praise the Lord. Look at me. I'm healed. I no longer am a leper. He was happy and joyous, and he's praising God, Jehovah God. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Now, a Samaritan is a half-Jew, half-Gentile, and he was not even allowed in the inner courts of the temple as a Samaritan. So we see this. And so he comes to Jesus and thanking him. And Jesus said, wait a minute, were not all 10 cleansed? Even though Jesus didn't see them, he knew all 10 were cleansed. He says, were not all 10 of you cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Then he said to him, to the man, rise and go, your faith has made you well. Amazing, isn't it? Up to this point, all 10 men were one in action. They were one in unison. They acted in unison. They all together asked for help and prayed from God and from the Lord. And now one of them, when he saw that he had been healed, instead of going to the priest, he turns back and he goes to Jesus. Why? He recognized that he had been in the presence of God in Christ. He recognized that the one who healed them was the one who needed to get the praise, glory, and honor to, not to the priest or anyone else. What he did, others should have done, but did not. He alone glorified God. He alone fell on his face at the feet of Jesus and worshiped and praised Jesus for what he had done. He alone gave thanks. The other 9 were gone, but not him. He came. You know, you may be the only one worshiping God at one time or one point in your life. Continue to do so. Don't ever give up. Again, I go back to an example of Daniel. Daniel and his men, and they all were put into captivity. Yet Daniel continued to worship God and pray to God alone. 3 times a day he would pray. He would thank God alone. You and God. He alone came back. Where are the other nine? Again, even though he was barred from the temple, even though after he was clean, because of the fact he was a Samaritan, from worshiping God, he came back and he worshiped God incarnate in the person of Jesus Christ. If you notice, he said he threw himself at the feet of Jesus and thanked him, worshiping and praising him for what he had done in his life. This man, alone out of the ten, was again miraculously healed along with the ten, but now he received a second miracle. A second blessing took place in his life. Salvation has come upon him. Here, when Jesus said, "Rise and go, your faith has made you well," he wasn't speaking about his physical condition because he was already healed of that. He was talking about his spiritual condition. Because here the man had put faith and trust in Jesus Christ. He was his Lord and his Savior as he was kneeling there before him. And this is why Jesus says, "Rise and go, your faith has made you well." He had received. His faith in Jesus made him not only physically healed, but also spiritually healed as well. You know, in life, people, we all have two choices in life. We can either believe what the Word of God says concerning that of Jesus Christ and his salvation and comes through him, or we can believe the devil's lie and say, "You're not good enough. You don't have to do all that. You can wait. You have time." But no one has time. All we have is today. We can be contented with the experiencing of physical life things that God has put upon us and never embrace the spiritual side. There are many people who do that. But yet, there's also the spiritual side, to embrace Jesus as Master, as Savior, and cry out to him in repentance. Like the parable that Jesus so proclaimed about the tax collector and the Pharisee in Luke chapter 18, where in this parable, the tax collector says, "Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner." Recognizing our own self. I am a sinner in need of God's grace. And that comes by knowing Jesus Christ. Because by what he has done at Calvary, he has cleansed me and made me whole again. And so here we see, it is one thing to be thankful for our physical things. And we have a lot to be thankful for. A whole bunch, if you think about it. I don't care how young you are, how old you are. We all have so much to be thankful for. That God has blessed us, what God has done for us, and what he's given to us. And yet, it's another thing to be thankful for our eternal life that comes by putting faith in Jesus. Only by what he has done at Calvary can we have eternal life. And we see what took place. Today, I will caution you, warn you, plead with you, do not be like the other nine. After receiving mercy and grace from God, they never came back. They never praised God. They never said thank you. But not only that, none of the other nine received eternal life that comes by knowing Jesus Christ. The question is your faith in Jesus, is it real? Or you like the other nine. You're going about just doing things. Don't wait until it's too late. Come to Jesus and be healed completely. Not just physically, but spiritually. See, it's more important to know where you are spiritually. It's more important to know what is your relationship like with the Lord. Is it where it should be? Or if not, you can make it today. You can make it happen today by putting faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Let us stand. Almighty God, as we come before you again, Lord, we thank you for your message. We thank you for your words that you have so given to us. If there's anyone here this morning that truly does not know you as Lord and Master, I pray today they will settle the matter and that they will give their heart and their life to you today. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen. Turn, if you will, to hymn number 312. As the hymn says, softly and tenderly, as we sing all songs, and if the Lord has put upon your heart to come, make it right today, as we sing 312. God has mercy, and that mercy is found in Jesus Christ. he can help. And he has helped. He can help anyone regardless of how deep they may think they are. Allow the Lord to lift you up with the power and might that he can. I pray God's blessing upon each and every one. This coming Wednesday, we'll have Bible study back in the back at 7 o'clock. As always, if you can't cook, we have food. We always hit do. Ginger's always bringing food. I don't know what Ginger's going to bring this one. There's no telling. I know what loaf the Lord is going to bake up. There's no telling. But anyhow, if you come, want to come, come. And come early if you want. 6:15, 6:30, that's fine. You can come early and join us for food and for fellowship. And then afterwards at 7 o'clock, we have Bible study from 7 to 8. Come and join us for that. If not, we invite you to come back next Sunday, 9 o'clock for Sunday school, or 10:30 worship service. Come and let's worship the Lord in spirit and truth together. Al, lead us in closing prayer, please.
Heavenly Father, we again come for you in prayer. We thank you again for all that you've done for us, for watching over us, for keeping us, for being with us 24 hours a day, Father, 7 days a week, always with us. Yes. Again, we pray for those that weren't able to be with us this morning. We know that we have some sick, and we know we have some that's hard for them to get out at certain times. Be with them, Father. Let them know again that they are in our prayer. Thank you for your word. And Father, I pray for each one here. I pray, Father, that we will look to you for leadership and guidance each and every day. And, Father, we will recognize and we will be thankful for all that you've done for us. I pray now, Father, that you'll be with us as we leave here, go our separate ways, bring us back to worship again together. In thy Son's precious name we pray. Amen.